being, again, a mid-bridge utility mid laner like Lulu. Mm-hmm.
There's the Echo ban once again. Now Kalista banned away from Deft. Shen, interestingly enough, banned away from Zatai. Again, this is picks and bans for game number two between EDG and IG. We just saw an incredible game number one, and will EDG produce similar results this time around? Seems IG are taking their time with this ban after that Shen.
Well, likewise, since Echo was taken away, they're able to look for a target ban, so they put that one on to Mako. Ryze is still on the board.
Yep.
Never mind.
They can hear you through time and space.
So EDG, by banning Ryze and Echo from purple side, allow Invictus Gaming two target bans.
Interesting.
That's one way to say it.
We'll see how that plays out, as it might be EDG playing into that. We'll see what IG decide to take from that last pick. As you can see, the coach on the right side of IG talking with his team, trying to figure everything out. And last one is going to be Koro's Maokai.
That said, leaves the Gragas open, so going to deny that to Kakao. Clearlove has had a much stronger performance on Gragas in the last coming weeks than his initial exposure to that champion.
Yeah, we'll have to see how Clearlove ends up doing on that Gragas this time around after we saw the Clearlove special with the Nunu in game number one to pretty moderate success. Some of those ganks were unique, to say the least, but
I think they should go Corki Victor.
Yeah, we'll have to see how IG decide to trade it out. Looks like they do want to take away the Azir instead from Pawn. Yeah, Corki now locked in for Kid, and we'll see if this Azir gets locked in.
It makes sense. Azir is going to have a longer range than Victor, so it's a bit of a tough lane, at least initially, before Victor is able to upgrade his Hex Core and then get the level 9, level 10 bonus AD and just clear that back line with the evolution point. So it makes sense.
Okay. We'll see how EDG decide to respond with it, as Ezreal is still open. This is patch 5.12. So that Runeglaive Ezreal, very strong. Braum now picked up by Mako. And yeah, there's the Ezreal picked up. Could be flexed to Deft, but we've seen Pawn's Ezreal before.
Yep, and Pawn played a fantastic Runeglaive Ludens Echo Ezreal. And again, that's the important thing about 5.12, is that the Ludens will still affect the Runeglaive.
Yeah, we'll have to see how that works out for Pawn if he decides to go with it or if he tosses it over to Deft. IG now once again on the picking side of things, looking for a bit of a different style composition, perhaps taking a page out of EDG's book, as it looks like it's going to be Janna and Rek'Sai for Kitties and Kakao, and they'll lock it in.
One of my big things about Kitties, he is one of the longer, older standing supports of the LPL left over from the legacy days of Invictus. He was the addition after Xiao Xiao, if you want to talk about the true legacy roster of Invictus Gaming. He's not very good at playing disengage supports. His primary, if you think back to kind of the core of the Chinese support, you know, bringing that Annie back in Season 3 with Tabe, it's about that hard engage, Thresh, Annie, things like that. So, can play Janna. But the last time we've seen it, it's been kind of a question mark.
Mm. We'll have to see how that works out as EDG commit to the poke composition as Varus is locked in and Rumble picked up for Koro in the top to round things out for EDG. So IG down to the last pick. It's going to be for Zatai, Aurelia being looked at.
Zatai really wanting to take a carry role in his team. Yasuo to Aurelia if that gets locked in. I'm actually really curious if that Varus is going to go in the hands of Deft or if it's being used as a flex.
Ooh, we'll see if that's the case as it's last second swapped away from Aurelia and onto Viz for Zatai to round out IG's team.
They've got a lot of backline threat, good reposition and reset with Janna, and decent poke and siege. So again, another very well-balanced composition coming out of Invictus, which on the other side, they're still swapping. Which one's it going to be?
Ooh, I think they're both okay with either, so they're just going to keep swapping until they run out of time. But Pawn on Varus.
So taking the God V special, which still super curious because Pawn had a fantastic performance on Runeglaive Ezreal, and it is considered very strong on this patch. Hasn't been changed at all, but instead taking that Varus.
Yeah, so we're going to run through the lineups right quick. You can see Koro on Rumble, Zatai on Fizz. Here's Clearlove and Kakao once again in the jungle. Clearlove looking menacing as ever. Kakao trying to do the same. Here is Pawn and Rookie. I was going to say Rookie looks menacing, but that guy looks so happy.
He looks adorable.
Yeah, here's Deft and Kid rounding out the AD carry role. Lastly, Kitties and Mako, the man himself on that Braum. Looks to be an exciting match once again.
Yeah, Mako was one of the first Chinese, LPL supports to jump on the Braum hype train with the changes on 5.12 to Braum's Q.
Yeah, well, we'll have to see how that works out as we're ready to get into game number two between EDG and IG right now. And we have returned to the Rift. Welcome back, everyone. It's EDG versus Invictus Gaming. This is week number 8, day number 2, set number 4, match number 2. And will be our last game of the day. After taking a very convincing game number 1, EDG look to close out this series with another 2-0 this weekend.
Would be kind of a change of pace of what we've seen over the last 3 weeks. But again, playoff format has changed. It's down to the wire.
Yeah, a lot of pressure being placed on scoring higher in the bracket with that playoff change. We've been talking about it since yesterday, all throughout the day as well. As soon as we've got a way to show that to you, we'll be able to bring it up. But again, it's weighted gauntlet style for the bottom six. Top two automatically seed into the final four, and the remaining six have to gauntlet their way into those top two spots. Kakao, though, looking like he might find Deft. Is he starting with the knockup? He is. It's double knockup. Deft flashes away. He takes some big damage. Goes low. Is it going to be first blood? The auto attack goes to Kitties. He's the one who secures it. Though EDG are in a bad position as IG continue to provide chase. Pawn goes low. The knockup finds him. Another auto attack. It's not enough, and they get away.
That said, they do pick up the first blood on Deft. Kakao will take a bit of punish in his jungle, starting with the Unburrow. So, should need a nice long leash there.
Yeah, Kakao did burn his flash on top of it, so IG coming out of the gates nice and quick, picking up that kill, and Deft burned both of his summoner spells.
And still continues down into the bottom side map. That said, Invictus Gaming are going to quickly look for, I believe that they assume that Deft will lane swap because he doesn't have both summoners, so he's looking for an easy way to bypass the 5 minutes till his flash comes back up. And they're not trying to lane swap to get away from Ezreal Braum.
Yeah, so that is going to be a lane swap initiated by IG. Koro going for a recall instead of double jungle. He's going to teleport to the top and find Kid. Kitty's taking the long way around to try finding Clearlove in the jungle. Will spot him, but I don't believe he's going to be able to do anything too crazy. Yeah, instead they just kind of pass like ships in the night.
Yeah, and the reason why Clearlove is standing on the back of his wolf pit is because he's expecting, with corking the top lane, Kitties to be kind of hunting around for him, so hiding himself in the back corner there.
Yeah, here in the mid lane, you've got Pawn and Rookie trading it out. You can see Pawn using that arrow as best he can to try harassing Rookie out of lane, but just not quite finding any crazy harass just yet. Mako looking to head to the top side to help Koro out as Kid and Kitties continue to provide pressure on that top side of the map. Should be just fine.
They're pulling Kakao as well because they need to break the freeze that's happening. So they want to push this wave in, reset it. Likewise, if they looked for an opportunity to get a gank, obviously they would have gone for it. But it's more importantly about trying to reset this wave so they can put it in the middle of the lane and start denying Koro some of the CS.
Yeah, so the freeze is not going to be successful for Koro on that top side. Unfortunately, that means he will have to go toe-to-toe with Kid and Kitties, though Kitties with a bit of a roam gets a nice deep ward. On the other side, however, that means that Deft and Zatai get to farm it up. And we saw Zatai do reasonably well on that Yasuo in game number 1, but it seems like there might be a bit of importance placed on him once again this time around.
Yeah, but more importantly, they're running a kind of a triple threat composition and giving Rookie much more carry potential with this late game Azir. Godvi has been a big proponent of taking Varus into mid-range. I'm not going to call it mid-range. How about control mages like Viktor, like Azir? Because Varus's piercing arrow is one of the few abilities that can outrange as well as push the lane. So look for that. It's going to be very similar to a Jace build. You're going to go into your tier, Mirror Mana, Last Whisper, Brutalizer. Get some CDR boots, and it's just about pumping out as many various Qs as possible.
Yeah, we'll see if Pawn is able to use that to the same success that Godvi had previously, as he is going for a sustained build as well. Clear Love on his recall, opts for the Ranger's Trailblazer, gets spotted out by a ward, but it's perfectly fine giving vision of that. And it seems like things are off to a nice slow start with vision of that, however. Kakao actually looking like he might have gone for a bit of a roam towards the mid, but Pawn with an Omana actually gets a timely recall.
Yep, which means that Kakao will just go back to power farming, possibly looking bottom, knowing that Def doesn't have his flash. That said, Def doing a great job pulling the wave into him. Will we see a dive? There's a lot of potential here because Fizz has the ability to reset tower aggro with his playful trickster.
See if he commits to it. Clear Love shows himself on the top side. Kakao was backing away, but headed back down to the Tribush. Finally, he can't make up his mind as to whether he wants to do it or not.
They were looking for where Mako was, and so now that they see him top, they can re-engage on this idea. The only scary thing is that they don't know where Clear Love is.
Ooh, Deft gets a Trinket Ward, spots it out, and continues to play nice and safe.
Curious, we didn't get a chance to touch on this. Pawn actually started with the Flask on Varus as opposed to a Doran's item or possibly even Boots and Pot, so getting a lot of respect to Rookie, and that's one of the nice things about Rookie. Unfortunately, we didn't get to really talk about it last game with him when he was on a Lulu, but Rookie has fantastic lane control, one of the better LPL mid laners, and just kind of understanding wave management, positioning, and brilliant trading.
We'll see if he can continue to trade effectively with Pawn, as he was able to keep pace with Pawn in game number one. This time it looks like he does have about a 14 minion CS lead, though Pawn should be closing that difference up just a bit as the wave crashes into his turret. Yep, thank you, cameraman, for knowing across time and space that we wanted to look at that. Yep, manages to bring it down to a 10 CS lead. But again, that's Azir versus Varus. That's to be expected early on. Interestingly enough, Pawn actually took Exhaust for one of his summoner spells, not going for Cleanse or Barrier.
He's not facing against a ton of CC that he would be able to cleanse. Barrier's a preference choice, but he's got, again, so much backline threat that he's facing against in Fizz, Rek'Sai, and Azir that it makes sense that you would pull the Exhaust, because as soon as, you know, Fizz hops back there, Azir looks for the insect, Rek'Sai burrowing, you just press Exhaust.
Mako.
That was cute.
Has to jump out, styles his way on out of that jump. And Zetai, he did receive a bit of pressure from Clear Love and Mako, but was able to dodge a majority of it without burning any of his summoner spells, and continues to farm it up, though a recall sends the duo of Kid and Kitties down to the bottom. And Zetai looks like he's going to head to the top, so we've seen pretty standard farm coming out of these two so far. No crazy action, but now that we've got both of the 2v2s once again on the bottom side, could we be seeing any sort of early dragon action?
There's always going to be the potential right there, but it's also in either team's best interest to prolong and elongate the lane phase, just because their power spikes are going to come through mostly itemization. And then you have a double tier composition coming out of EDG first and foremost, although they will have a massive mid-game power spike. But hold on.
Mako gets destroyed. The knockups are coming across left and right. He's taken so much. He jumps out of there and makes it out alive, though he still takes some poke from Rookie. Pawn doesn't have enough mana. Kakao looking for the knockup. Can't quite find it, but Mako, ooh, he's flirting with danger. Here comes some more poke across from the side. Deft joining up with the rest of his team.
Again, a bilingual team. Pawn flashes forward to give Mako the correct spacing so he can stand behind him. United? I don't know. I think it's stand behind me.
Yep.
Hop to Varus to safety.
Yeah, so Mako making it out with his life. As you mentioned, excellent communication from EDG. And despite that first blood, going over to IG from picking up the kill onto Death, his summoner spells are now back up. It's dead even in gold, and we're actually starting to see a bit of a CS lead open for Clearlove as he's netting about 400 gold ahead of Kakao.
Just really power farming. This goes back to the fact that Kakao was kind of uncharacteristically indecisive when he was looking at the initial dive on Deft bottom after the first blood. During that time, the reason Kakao didn't pull the trigger is because A, initially he didn't have eyes on Mako, and then secondly, he didn't have eyes on Clearlove. Clearlove was farming it up.
Again, things going towards a nice patient laning phase. The poke and harass coming out from Ezreal and Corki. Deft even Arcane shifting aggressively forward for better landing his Mystic shot.
He's got full control of the minion wave, which means he's more than capable to do that without sacrificing anything or taking too much minion aggro damage. Likewise, Ezreal typically has a fairly weak matchup in a lot of cases, but having the Sheen and the tier available, he's pretty much on par for the damage that Corki's going to be doing and isn't losing out on any battle stats that he normally would in this particular matchup.
Yeah, so again, things very slow and calm in this early game. Kakao secures his red buff, Clearlove spots him out as he was looking for a bit of a steal himself, though a collapse from Koro. Looks like they might be heading towards the mid lane to find Rookie. This could be a scary situation as Kakao sees Clearlove over the wall here. They know that it's a bit of a tricky situation, but instead Clearlove plays it safe. Koro heads back to the top.
No reason to try to overextend, especially because Varus is more than happy just to continue and farm, stack his tier.
Deft does some serious damage here. He actually forces the recall. Oh, Kid actually dashes into it and gets chunked down to about 100 health. He's still going to make it out alive, but this gives Deft some free time with that turret.
Likewise, unfortunately. Oh, hold on.
Oh, looks like the fish isn't quite able to land. Zatai gets destroyed by Clearlove. Thought he could 1v1, but ended up getting 1v2.
And I was going to say, unfortunately for EDG, they have complete control of the bottom lane. Clearlove does get a successful gank, and it translates into them getting the bottom two tower because Kakao's prioritized top. But they're not able to translate this into dragon control because their jungler is across map. So, still good for EDG, but could have had more.
Certainly could have, but not quite able to find too much. They did take that first turret and a kill. Dragon still on the map as Pawn continues to farm it up in the mid wave. And everyone returns to those standard laning phases. Koro heads back to the top. Zatai doesn't want to burn his teleport to get to the top side, so he misses a few minions. And there's the Void Rush now from Kakao to head on over to his Raptor camp and continue farming. Deep Horde came out of Kitties to spot the red buff of Clearlove. Entirely certain what he's looking for there. Might be trying to take that bottom tier one with the untimely recall from Deft.
He's just trying to set up deep vision so they can see how aggressively and how far forward they can push onto this tower. It's just a high traffic area.
Ooh, looks like Kid is going to be able to take the turret. Yeah, Kitties takes a few hits, but that turret is now secured. And it's traded one for one overall in turrets. Still dead even in gold now that turret has been taken. Clearlove going for a bit in bit of an invade with Mako, might be hoping for some deep wards, and let's actually talk a little bit about the vision for EDG. They've got some pretty solid control over that bottom side right now.
Likewise, it's very well mirrored by Invictus on kind of the opposite side, so both teams having great vision control, especially around this dragon objective, which is now being pinged multiple times as Kakao's caught.
Yeah, he's taken some serious damage here. Tunnels out to safety. The knockup from Mako, but he just doesn't have any backup. Def doesn't have the True Shot Barrage. Rookie goes in, but Zatai teleports, actually completes it, but isn't able to find anything.
Rookie was going back in to look for the Azir Sec. Unfortunately, I think he was tagged with a slow or is having some pathing issues. Decides not to commit his flash onto it, but with EDG getting full control and forcing Kakao back, doesn't have the Void Rush available. They can actually turn onto Dragon, but it looks like they're going to prioritize this structure.
They're putting some damage out with that crazy poke from Pawn and Deft. There goes the True Shot Barrage. Doesn't quite find any champions, but clears the wave. They're actually buying a lot of time for Koro on the top lane, who you can see is 24 CS ahead with the completed Abyssal Scepter.
I love Abyssal Scepter. You know I love Abyssal Scepter, which is why you handed that to me.
Yes.
But we have so much magic damage on the side of EDG, as it's actually Invictus Gaming. So EDG, I call this a mistake. They had full control to walk over to that dragon pit, but they don't pull the trigger and let Invictus walk up and take it for free.
Yeah, and IG now secure that first dragon for themselves. They're still down a minor amount in gold. Should be able to defend this turret. Mako goes aggressive but deft with the poke. He's got to back away from taking some damage from Rookie. And ooh, there goes some more damage from Pawn, but he decides not to commit to it too much as Kakao looks for a bit of a flank from the side.
Yeah, I'm... That was interesting. Unique. Curious. Here we go. Here's a dive.
Yeah, the dive onto Zatai. Luckily, that is Fizz. There goes a flash from Zatai. He makes it out.
He flashed at the perfect moment that the knockup from the fish hit him, so Clearlove couldn't throw down the cast to bounce him back. That was really well played.
Oh, here comes the rest of IG. Could be trying to punish EDG for taking that top tier two, and while that objective has been secured, EDG are playing this game very slowly.
Okay, so Invictus' next priority objective for them is going to be that mid-tier tower. They can start to shift their vision to the top side of the map, although they do have a ton of control over the bottom side. Should be looking for some deep vision, but they really need to start applying pressure and taking advantage of their lead that they have. I say lead, but they're actually down still 1k due to the tower being taken in the top lane.
But that gold's on the map. It's available for them to take.
Yeah, but it's also kind of the itemization differences between them. The fact that
that was cute.
The fact that Kid has the Trinity Force complete versus Deft not having that power spike available. So there's a brief window of opportunity where IG are in control, which now it's gone because Deft has it.
Now dead even between these two teams. Once again, looking very similar to what we saw in game number one, but this time EDG in a very different team composition.
It's a poke siege comp. Yep.
Looks to be a very powerful comp. We'll see if they're able to make effective use of it this time around. 16 and a half minutes in, we've seen some pretty consistent farming out of just about everyone. And speaking of farm, Pawn still keeping pace with Rookie, just barely behind him, whereas the AD carries are dead even on top of it. The only person who's really got a distinct lead is going to be Koro, who's up by about 40.
Distinct is the way to put that. That is 133 to 91. That said, Koro has not gone back and bought for a very long time, so he's relatively even still with Zatai in terms of itemization, as EDG trying to do what their comp does best and approach a tower.
Have to see if they're going to be able to poke it down. There goes the True Shot Barrage. Finds Rookie, the most valuable target for defending that turret, though. We've still got Kitties for the Eye of the Storm defense on that turret. Here comes Pawn. He's ready and prepared. Oh, yeah. Clears out the minion wave right quick. Siege continues unabated. Will they be able to take this turret down in time? Clearlove looking for a bit of a flank. Is he going to commit?
Just waiting for IG to misposition or commit too far one way or the other.
Yeah, so excellent poke coming out of EDG right here. Pawn doing so much damage with that piercing arrow. Zatai, he was at full health when he showed up there.
Meanwhile, Koro was applying pressure up into the top lane. That said, EDG going to go ahead and decide that they don't want to continue this siege. Mana bar is very low. Obviously much harder to do when your mid laner, Varus, doesn't have a blue buff.
Yeah, now we're getting to 18 minutes into the game. Rookie on his recall completes his Morellos and opts for the Sword Boots. Continues to put pressure onto the mid, and you can see Clearlove pretty happy. He's in the zone right now.
Kakao has shored up the CS discrepancy between the junglers, however, which is pretty massive. We have to think the last time we checked in on them, Clearlove had, you know, 10, 15, close to 20 jungle camp advantage, and it's now actually in Kakao's favor with that skull grab.
Kakao finally going to be taking the lead this time. He is level 9 to the level 10 of Clearlove. As Pawn, interestingly enough, heads to the top side to continue farming it out. Looks like EDG are content to sit and play a passive game.
The thing about Pawn, putting him on low mobility champions like Varus, is that I feel like it detracts from a lot of things that Pawn is naturally good at. So if we want to think about him as the skirmish mid laner, as the guy who kind of goes off on his own, walks into the enemy jungle and just straight up murders someone, it's much harder to do that, much more dangerous to to walk into Fog of War on someone as fragile as Varys. I mean, even when he's on his Runeglaive Ezreal, he still has a reposition available on the Ezreal E. So.
Looks like a dive trying to find Kara. Will he be able to make it out of this one? One, two, three knockups are going to find him. He drops and Kakao is the one who gets the kill.
Brilliant pick from Invictus Gaming, and there is zero response from EDG. They are not in position anywhere on the map, and again, I feel like it goes back to this isn't the role that Pawn normally plays in this team. We're not seeing the crazy aggressive plays and the pressure point that he can apply in that mid lane through the Varus pick versus something else.
Definitely have to see if he can be effective over the duration of this game. So far, looks like he's having a bit of trouble. Deft farming it up on the bottom side.
When was the last time you saw a 20-minute game where Pawn was 0-0-0?
I have no idea. 20 games ago?
Here we go. They're going to fight for this dragon. Koro teleports in, doesn't have Equalizer available. That's a big key ultimate that very important for securing dragons.
To see if he is going to be able to use that in time as EDG decide to try to make the best of their bad positioning and head up towards the mid lane. They're going to find this mid tier one undefended and successfully. Oh, no.
Unsuccessful.
Yeah, unsuccessfully. Ah,
hero minion.
That minion tried so valiantly. He just wanted to crit. That's all he wanted to do.
Don't you hate it when the minions crit you? For like 2,000.
It's so ridiculous. Mm-hmm. But
look at the blue buff.
Finally, not able to get the steal. Turret finally goes down. IG have got the better positioning on the dragon. Ping's going out.
Yeah, EDG are way too split up. Pawn is on the wrong side of that fight. He needs to walk around to either the other side or the team needs to join him.
Okay. IG are a bit hesitant pulling the trigger on this one, though. They don't want to take any chances either.
Both teams being super respectful. With that back, though, I think this is Invictus just forfeiting the dragon. Nope.
No recalls coming out.
EDG have complete control. Kakao does have Void Rush available if he chooses to go back and quickly get himself back into position.
Zatai is looking for the flank. He's going to try assassinating someone. Take a look at this build. He's going Assassin Fizz. EDG start the dragon. IG get forward. It resets. Oh, no. It resets. Zatai is there to catch it at 2,000 health. EDG misplayed that just a little bit. They're going to have to contest it now in close range. Oh, it's picked up by Kid. EDG look for the fight. There's the reset. Knockup is stacked perfectly with Koro's Equalizer. It's so great he gets a kill. They continue to chase over the wall. Pawn gets another one. Zatai running for his life. There goes another piercing arrow. Flash is going to find Zatai. There's the explosive cast on the Kiddies. He's picked up now, and EDG mop this up cleanly.
Again, though, so great performance from Pawn in that fight, standing above on the ramp. They lose the dragon, simply a misplay from Clearlove. He was clearly in smite range. In fact, both junglers didn't smite. It's Corki who ends up with the jungle. Gonna see the replay here. So, yep, Clearlove, he had that, man. Here comes the engagement. Beautiful equalizer from Koro lands across three members of Invictus Gaming, completely destroys Kakao. Zatai hits his fish on Koro, not able to follow up with it, and then it's just a zone control. Now the thing is that in EDG are running a poke comp, and so typically with a poke comp, you want to lay down your poke before you then look for the big engagement, but they're playing this poke comp like they would any sort of 5v5 comp, but it's working for them because they're EDG, they're brilliant at team fighting, but that's not necessarily how that works. So that's a bit concerning.
Well, look at Paul smiling. He knows it too. He's like, gosh, those American casters, they really know what they're talking about. So we're 23 minutes in. It's 6-2. Now it's...
It's funny. When Pawn was at MSI, Fizz is a massive champion now, yeah? Mm. But Pawn has played Fizz historically throughout his career. Even when he wasn't a massive champion, he was considered an off-meta pick. And you would ask Pawn, you'd be like, so why do you play off-meta picks like Fizz? And he would just, like, stone-face you. What do you mean off-meta? What's wrong with my picks? My picks are fine. You don't like Fizz? It was excellent. No, Fizz is fine. This is cool. Wow.
Well, now he's got Varus on top of Azir, so I hesitate to say that he's playing some more standard styles, but you can never be too certain what Pawn is thinking.
He has a... I think he's played 22 unique champions over the course of the LPL split. I don't think any... I think he's... maybe God V might rival him in just kind of unique picks, but just absurd champion pool.
BG with timely rotation managed to find the mid tier one. It takes some damage and finally goes down to the concentrated attack damage from Pawn and Deft, and IG just caught on the back foot there.
They're in their, as we like to say, power spike. You've got the Mirror Mana completed and upgraded for Ezreal, as well as the Trinity Force. But more importantly, this is where Varus is powerful. He's got the Last Whisper, the Brutalizer, doesn't have the upgraded Mirror Mana or the tier completely stacked. He's got the CDR boot, so this is the window where EDG can start to run through Invictus, or should be looking to make these sieges happen.
See if they are going to be able to succeed in doing that, or if IG will be able to drag it out just like they did in game number one. Satai looking for a bit of a pick here, doesn't quite find it as the Ward over the wall spots Kakao. He is not able to smite it. Damage finds Mako in the front, but that's the tanky frontliner who needs to be absorbing the damage. True Shot Barrage comes across Koro with the flank, doesn't quite find anyone. Let's see if he can tag Satai. Nope, lets him walk away. And they disengage successfully.
Big problem with the composition is that they do have long-range engage tools with Braum ultimate as well as the Equalizer from Koro. That said, they were on the hunt there in the jungle trying to force Invictus to fight them, but Invictus have a ton of tools to just walk away from EDG at any point that they want.
Seems like that's exactly what they did in that last opportunity, but this time around, continuing to take it nice and slow. Zatai farming it up. You can see he's closed some of that CS difference quite a bit. No longer 40 in favor of Koro. Only 15 or so in favor of Koro. Though Zatai continues to shove on that bottom side to pull attention away as best he can. Some poke coming out from Pawn. Doesn't find anyone that he's looking for. 26 minutes in. The next dragon's going to be up in 2 minutes, and EDG probably are going to want it because that first dragon buff is a little important for their scaling team.
Hold on, though.
Ooh, damage over the wall. Finds Kitties. He goes low. There's the cast. Clearlove nets the kill.
Dunked. That said, Kitties has discovered that they were looking at the Baron, which alerts the rest of Invictus Gaming to head over to the area. So Kitties has sacrificed his life, but EDG don't get a free purple bomb.
Not quite able to, though they do still have complete and total vision over that side of the jungle. IG are going to immediately respond by swinging mid and successfully take down that mid tier one before claiming that turret as their own.
A lot of back pings coming out as Invictus Gaming was looking on a flank, but Deft and Clearlove quickly trying to get out of that area. Dragon will be spawning within the next minute. Meanwhile, Coral has created quite a sizable pressure point on the bottom side of the map. EDG need to reset the map, push all of their waves, even them out, back, pick up some vision, and head towards this dragon.
Yeah, you can see some of the gold on the screen right now. About 1,100 in favor of Pawn over Rookie. It's the permanent xylophone going hard for Kid.
I think the camera guy was just really interested in it.
What instrument is that? I don't know. Oh, it's a xylophone.
Is it really?
Sure
it
is.
Huh.
I would think it is.
Oh, I thought you just knew.
Yes.
Fun facts with
I have an innate sense. Whenever I hear a sound, I can tell whether or not it's a xylophone.
No, I just mean,
like, for example, that's not a xylophone.
Okay. I just thought that maybe you knew working in the NA office. Dragon is up and available. EDG are the first team on the scene, which means that they have the vision priority. That said, not a big deal because Invictus Gaming do have Rek'Sai. She's able to approach things fairly safely with the Tremor Sense, but if she's late to the party...
Yeah, that could be a bit of a problem. Dragon is secured for EDG. That's Dragon number one. They're all grouped up on this side. Will they look for a fight? Stacking the Braum ultimate on top of the Equalizer from Koro. Worked so well for them last time. Can they find the angle this time?
They need to rotate to the top wave, take care of that, move their vision into red side, and either make a pick, translate to Baron, or reset the wave top and look to siege that outer.
Yeah, seems like they're just going to continue playing defensive as they're catching the wave on the slow side. Pawn continues farming it up in the mid from a distance, using that piercing arrow to make sure he doesn't get too close. As Def continues to play safe on the far side of this minion wave. Doesn't want to take any chances.
He's trying to push it in. Pawn's just making sure that there can't be a counter push mid lane. Meanwhile, Koro is setting up a slow push to the bottom side, but they want the top side of the map.
Ooh, 1,500 gold lead for Deft. We're starting to see some pretty big numbers opening up from EDG just about all across the board. Again, Koro now 30 CS back ahead of Zetai. Poor guy can't catch a break.
Spending all of his time on the bottom side of the map. A little depth to pick up. He's looking for his Blade of the Rune King, so going for more of a purple Ezreal. No? Okay.
I'm thinking about how that's going to end up working into this.
I think it's just safety because of the backline dive threat again. The fact that you have the Unburrow, the Fizz, Playful Trickster, Azir, that the Bork is just going to give him that extra added tool to step away, as opposed to actual shred against a tanky member.
Oh, Deft gets way too aggressive there, takes some significant damage, and is forced to jump away, even burning the flash and the heal. True Shot Barrage finds Rookie. There's the Equalizer on top of it. Here's Mako looking to turn the fight around. He interrupts the Monsoon Channel, but whoa, somebody gets knocked way out of position. Zetai goes low, but he's going to go down here. Whoa, finally ends up getting dropped. Man, I didn't even know Deft could displace that far. You can see Zetai not looking too happy with that.
Kakao does finally pick him up on the side, and this team fight may still be going.
It just might be, as EDG continue to provide chase. Kakao running off with Rookie, but is not quite able to find anyone, and suddenly, EDG, could they be doing the Baron right now? Oh my gosh, they're trying to go for the Baron!
They're turning on with the teleport. Kakao does have Void Rush available, as well as a tunnel right in front of the pit. There he goes!
Yeah, we'll see if he's going to be able to steal it away. You can see EDG burning through its health as quickly as possible. Rookie running as fast as his bird-like legs can carry him. Here's Kakao, he makes it over the wall. It's over down to 15, 1,600, does not succeed. He goes low. Here comes Rookie, can he save his carry? No, he's gonna end up going down as Kakao flashed over the wall. Kitties flashes to get out with his life, and EDG secure the Baron.
Kakao had the stronger smite in that. Clearlove leveled up on the Baron.
IDK, my BFF Jill. So that's Baron secured. Unfortunately, Deft was not alive, so he does not have the Baron buff for the time being, but just continuing to farm it up on the bottom side of the map. Now 50 CS ahead of Kid.
Let's be frank right here. That was an incredibly risky play from EDG. That's what I like to call a 50-50 Baron. In fact, most pros will tell you that the guy going in for the steal actually has like a 60-40 advantage because of the element of surprise. True, the team on the Baron can't communicate burst as far as the timing with the smite, but that's just absurd. If Kakao had gotten that Baron, that would have been a 4-minute pause on this game. Yeah, look, 14-13. Okay, so it's 13-13. So it was an even smite trade, and then he levels up as he gets the Baron smite. But still, this is so risky. If Invictus Gaming get that, they're right back into this game. I cannot believe that EDG made that play.
He smited too soon.
I mean, but you're still relying on the enemy team to screw up rather than you playing the game correctly.
So Kakao, unfortunately, not able to secure the Baron there. EDG with it now have a significantly stronger element added to their poke composition with Baroned up minions looking to be sieging their base as well. Now that top and bottom tier two turrets are the last ones still standing outside of the base for IG, though it seems like EDG have got their sights set on the bottom tier two first.
Clearlove already sitting off onto the side, does have the cask available, so we'll see if they just want to siege this tower, if they possibly would foot dive.
Goodness gracious, that poke. That was with a full overshield from the tier two turret, though it just keeps coming across.
Just shredding through it, the power of having double AD carry.
Kakao
going in. Oh, and the
hook finds him. Is he going to follow up the chain of corruption? No, he does not indeed. Instead, they decide to play it safe and just commit to the turret. Whew.
Really nice disengage from Clearlove to hit the belly bop on Kakao as he was looking for the Unburrow. He could have immediately gotten to the back line and opened up at least a little bit of a CC chain for Rookie to follow.
Yeah, as a five-man group, EDG don't look to stop here. They're continuing to find harass as Kid is just chunked out so low. He's got to Valk out of there. Finally, the turret goes down, and this is going to be the inhibitor. Zetai looking for the flank, but he just can't find an angle on this. Ooh, is Zetai going to commit to it? There goes the fish. Is he going to chum onto Clearlove? But he decides not to commit.
And this is how this composition is supposed to work. So again, we had some kind of wonky dragon fights where EDG just played it full 5v5 without laying down poke first, but finally in the driver's seat, 10k gold advantage, have the Baron. They're laying down the poke, looking for the siege, and they're in full control.
Yeah, now Dragon has just spawned. EDG are still on this side of the map. They no longer have the Baron buff anymore, but this is going to be their second Dragon that they secure now. 34 and a half minutes into the game. They're up 7 kills, 10k gold, and have just dropped IG's inhibitor. Once again, they're playing the game very slowly and patiently, similar to game number one, but this time they've got a much more concrete advantage compared to game number one as well.
Definitely agree. We still have some options late game for Invictus as we approach closer to that 35-40 minute mark with rookies Azir. See what they're able to do here. Do have to make sure that they manage that super creep wave bottom appropriately, but they could look for a pick.
Oh, looks like Mako is going to spot Kakao out of position, drop some wards over the wall to make sure he's not caught. They try to burst through his health and succeed. Pawn gets knocked back in with the Emperor's Divide. He goes low, almost picks up a kill, but finally drops. Clearlove rides the Divide over the wall, but cannot find the kill as Mako dodges the Chum the Waters. Here's the tie providing chase. He makes it in, finally is going to be able to secure the kill. And suddenly EDG looks like they're kind of in a bit of a bad position here. Yeah, and actually no, EDG Clearlove is able to turn it around, picking up the kill onto Zatai, and IG have to back away.
And that was best case scenario. We talked about how Invictus are looking for a pick. The reason why they position on the top side of the map is because it's the last standing outer tower. So it's going to be the easiest objective for EDG to siege. IG knew that they would be in the area. They make sure that they got there first, set it up, doesn't trade as cleanly as it could have, but it's a foot back in the door.
Oh, there goes the cast because they look for a dive. Equalizer finds Rookie. Kitties goes low and gets burned to a crisp from Koro's Equalizer damage. Here's Kakao having rejoined the battle after respawning. So much damage coming across from Rookie. He brings Koro low, but Deft mops him right back up. They drop Kakao. Koro flashes out and gets out alive in 2v3, 3v3. EDG come out clearly ahead.
Deft turning it on, showing what he's famous for, and it's hitting these crazy skill shots on caster-based AD carries.
Ooh, they could be looking to end the game right now. As they dive into the base instead, they're going to try continuing to play it safe, instead focusing on taking that inhibitor. Zatai was waiting under the Nexus turrets to defend his base, make sure that it was nice and clean as the super minions push in from the other side. This is going to be the second inhibitor going down, and IG can't do nothing to stop it.
And they can easily rotate down to pawn and clean up number three. The reason why they dove into that base so deep is they knew that a super creep wave had been on the inhibitor tower, so they were just Nexus tower. So they were just checking to see how low it had gotten, if it needed one or two more autos.
Yeah, so just like that, all three inhibitor turrets are down for IG. EDG have got complete momentum, 14,000 gold ahead, 11 kills. Baron's gonna be up in another minute. Dragon looks to be another couple of two or three. And EDG, man, this team is unstoppable. The one thing that kept IG in game number one was the fact that they could team fight so clearly with EDG, but this time, EDG is not even giving Invictus Gaming a chance to team fight.
No, I completely agree. I mean, the last team fight that we really had was over that dragon where EDG just kind of mowed through them after Clearlove fumbled the smite. Since then, it's pretty much just been sieging. If you have the wave pressured, it's about throwing out your poke, and IG never finding a true full 5v5. One member is just a little bit too low that has to disengage.
IG are just not quite finding the engages that they want as EDG creep closer and closer to victory. Three Nexus turrets are down. Baron has spawned. EDG have got complete control of the pit. IG, they're overextended trying to do this. EDG, burn it down.
Kakao looking to get back into the pit. Clearlove trying to zone him.
Yeah, gets the knockup. Clearlove goes low. He's actually going to have to be careful here. One Nexus turret has gone down. EDG are just going to bait it out. There goes the Chain of Corruption on the Zatai. They flash for Pawn, but he's able to make it out alive. Kitty's looking over the wall. There goes the Equalizer and True Shot. They pick up one kill. Knockup finds Zatai. Can they get another one? Foss misses. There goes the Emperor's Divide, but it's not enough. Rookie just doesn't have the damage. Deft is still alive. Mako following with him. They managed to stay all five members of alive. EDG are cleaning this fight up as per usual, and IG are running. Koro teleports in and ends the game.
And meanwhile, while that team fight was going on, of course, Koro wasn't needed there. Teleports to the massive creep wave, crashing onto the Nexus Towers and cleans that one up for himself. So a little bit of a slow start for EDG. Had some questionable mid-game decisions, especially on that Baron call. But in the end, they put it together.
Yeah, eventually EDG were able to take the win that we have expected from them. Some amazing play over the duration of this. And, I mean, Deft, he's been playing a little bit shaky these past few weeks, especially with Baney, especially with Amazing J. It just seemed a little bit off. But now that he's back with Pawn, now that he's back with Koro, this guy is on his A game.
Yeah, it looked fantastic on that. Ezreal, we talked about how, you know, Pawn wasn't having the same performance on an impact on Varus as he would someone who's high mobility, able to kind of do his own thing and be self-sufficient. So EDG again, they flounder a little bit early, but they're able to find the 2-0, and that's two 2-0s back to back.
Yeah, Pawn, I have not seen this guy look so happy in a long time. He's been grinning throughout this entire set. And as you mentioned, that's two 2-0s for EDG. That brings them up to 30 points. It's hard to believe that at the beginning of this week, they were at 24. EDG are making a shot for that first place playoff spot.
And they're starting to really run away with it. But again, I have to emphasize this. A new playoff format is announced. And suddenly, what, we had three 2-0s today?
Yeah. Absolutely incredible.
Surprise, surprise.
Yeah, no more experimentation for these teams. No more crazy, wonky rosters. It's go time. And I cannot wait to see what we're going to see in the next few days and even weeks as we get closer and closer to playoffs.
Completely agree. So far, it looks like, I was just going to say, it wasn't necessarily experimentation in terms of, you know, rosters or things like that. I still feel like it was a bit of an experimentation as far as composition from EDG. Mm-hmm. However, playing more of a poke comp again, kind of translating Pawn's role in the team, putting him on a Varus. But we'll see. It worked out.
Yeah, so we'll go and bring up the bracket for you, the standings, so we can see where everyone fits on the standings right now. Edward Gaming in first place at 30. Xiaogu right behind him at 28 points, but things get a little bit closer as we go further down.
And by a little bit, we mean a lot. So OMG, after a fantastic day with their new AD carry north over Uzi, managed to find the 2-0 and have now moved up cleanly into the third place spot. But as soon as you get into fourth, sixth, and seventh, that's a 1 point difference, even all the way down to Vici.
Yeah, it's going to be a race to net those higher spots as we get closer to playoffs. Let's go ahead and take a look at the last page. Unlimited Potential still right behind them at 15 points, and Royal Never Give Up. They're 1-2-0 from being tied with Vici for that eighth place spot. And there's still a lot of potential for King or World Elite to make a play for the playoffs.
Yeah, and the easier way to kind of look and interpret these standings is to think top eight teams make it into playoffs. So the very first screen, all of those teams are qualified for playoffs. That second screen, those four teams, and there's like a 2 point difference between the top part of the four teams. Those are the guys who are battling to slip in at the very end.
Mm-hmm. And again, this is only week eight of the LPL. We've got three more weeks of high-octane Chinese League of Legends action coming soon. So we're going to go ahead and call it for a night. On behalf of myself, Frostgear, and the other casters, and the whole broadcast crew, thank you so much for watching. Be sure to come back